Good morning and welcome to everyone here seated in the sanctuary and visiting with us online at home. The Lord be with you. Today is actually the 24th Sunday after Pentecost. It's a lot of Sundays. Liturgically in our year, it's actually Christ the King Sunday today, which completes the season of Pentecost. Next Sunday, believe it or not, is the first Sunday of Advent. So we all have to prepare ourselves. A special welcome this morning if you're here as a visitor or guest. We're grateful to have you with us and pray that we will all find the rest that we're seeking, even the rest that the one who beckons us offers, saying, "Come to us all who are weary. Come to me all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." May we find rest today in our worship together. A few announcements as we begin. First, a thank you to our lay leaders who organized such a moving and meaningful service, Laity Sunday service last Sunday. Can I get an amen for that Sunday? It's wonderful. Also, a thank you to our United Women in Faith this morning for last Sunday's Super Bowl Super Sale. Not Super Bowl, Super Soup Sale. Say that three times fast. A reminder that their proceeds will be going to missions in our surrounding community. I'm excited also to announce this morning that our Capital Fund campaign to refurbish our children's playground is now at $23,000. We're two-thirds of the way onto our goal of $35,000. And so to reach our goal, we're extending our campaign to the end of the year. Thank you to everyone who's contributed to refurbishing our children's playground. As most of you are aware, today is Commitment Sunday here at St. Paul's. It's when we ask both friends and members of our church to submit an estimate of giving card for our life and ministry together in the coming year, 2023. Hopefully, you remembered or have remembered it. There is a card also, I believe, in everyone's bulletin. So following the message this morning, you'll be invited to come forward to place your card in the basket on the altar as a sign of your covenant for the coming year, both to God and to our community of faith. So please note, if you're not prepared to make an estimate of giving this morning, that there are other lines that you can check off to pray for the church in the coming year, to pray as you are able, or to give as you are able. So I hope you'll come and join the procession to place your card on the altar. And now I'd like to invite Jan Hill and Lori Angst as representatives of our Prayer Shawl Ministry to come forward.
Good morning, St. Paul's. Lori and I are here.
Where's Lori?
To highlight the Prayer Shawl Ministry. There are many people who have used their talent for knitting and crocheting to create these beautiful shawls that you'll see displayed here. They're given to people whom you all of our church members may know need some comfort and prayer and warmth. Feel free at the end of the service to take one if you know someone who could benefit from this. Also, I'd like to recognize those in the congregation who have knitted or crocheted. Put up your hand if you've done that. Uh-oh, we need more of you. Get out your needles. Our prayers are for all people in our congregation, but these are an especially wonderful way to share a prayer with someone in need. And Lori has something to say.
Hi, excuse me. I just also wanted to note that, you know, we do want additional folks that have the ability to crochet and knit to join us. We do need to make some more, and it's really a wonderful cause, and I did see some others raise their hands. If you are interested, we have patterns already, or you could use your own patterns. We've also got yarn out in the Narthex area that we do have, but we're also encouraging if anybody has yarn at home that they're not going to be using to donate to the cause, and if you can crochet or knit one yourself, and you have yarn at home, that would be wonderful. So, I just want to say thank you, because I know people that have received shawls that have just really been a blessing to them at a time in need. And now I would like to let you know that Pastor Dave is going to bless all of the shawls that we have here.
Together. May God's grace be upon all of these shawls, warming, comforting, enfolding, and embracing. May this mantle be a safe haven, a sacred place of security and well-being, sustaining and embracing in good times as well as in difficult ones. May the one who receives one of these shawls be cradled in hope, kept in joy, and graced with peace, and wrapped in love. Amen. Thank you. Just a reminder, you're welcome to take a shawl with you following the service if you have someone in mind you think would be blessed by a prayer shawl. Thank you. And now let us turn our hearts and minds to the worship of God as we listen to this morning's prelude. Can we get an amen for that? That was the title of Jeff's prelude, Come Ye Thankful People, Come. Suitable, of course, for our Thanksgiving holiday. Also a note that it's actually real fruit up here at the cornucopia. So I was impressed when I saw that. Thank you to our altar guild. Will you please rise now for our morning call to worship? On this Christ the King Sunday, the Lord reigns. Let us now lift our voices in thanksgiving as we sing together for the beauty of the earth. Let us pray. O Lord, who are we that you are mindful of us, and yet you have made us a little lower than the angels and have crowned us with your glory and given to us the responsibility for the works of your hands. May we be faithful this day and always with all that you have entrusted to us, that one day we may all hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Come now, Lord, come and inhabit the worship of your people. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
my mic on. It is now time for the children's moment of worship. Invite the children to come forward at this time. Can you see me in the back if I sit down? Maybe the top of my head? Let me know. Sort of? All right. I'm going to get up a little higher so the people in the back can see me. Good morning. Good morning. Do you have off this coming week? The whole week. Wow. Wow. Wonderful. Good news. Good news. Good morning. Good morning. Well, today, wanted to talk to you about treasures. Treasures. When I come home at night after a day out at church and on the town, I usually have a pocket that's sometimes full of what? Can you imagine? What do I have there? Yeah. Well, also known as change, right? I don't know how I got the word change. Somebody look that up for me, and I can, okay? And so when I come home at night and I'm getting ready for bed, I'll put my change in that can. Now, do some of you have piggy banks? Well, this is what I've been using. It's called a Bailey's cream, the original cream, Irish cream can. And that's where I put my treasure. My money, I put my treasure there every night before I go to sleep. And after a while, it starts to add up. Vivian, see how heavy that is, can you? Right? Yeah, that's a whole year's worth of change there. So I am building my treasure. I'm building my treasure on earth, my money. But the Bible says, and it's good to build treasure on earth, our money. We could use it to help pay for school or your retirement account or all kinds of things. But the Bible tells us to be careful that we don't store all of our treasures on earth, all of our money on earth, that we should invest in or put money away, or what's another word for invest? Save. Treasures in heaven. Save treasures in heaven. What could you imagine would be a treasure that we could save in heaven? That might be a little bit hard. What are some of the things we can save that don't, moth and rust don't destroy, or thieves can break in and steal? What are some of the things we can save? Any ideas? Let me give you some help. How about love? Is love like a treasure? If we give it to someone else, love can be like a treasure. You see, I have all these $10 bills. We'll put love on that, and that'll go into the treasure account. What are some other things that treasures that we can save in heaven or for heaven? How about forgiving someone? Have you ever had to forgive someone? That's often hard to do, but forgiving someone is a treasure that can be in that person's heart that could last forever. So forgiving one another is like saving a treasure that lasts forever, or a treasure in heaven. Can you think of any other treasures we could save? Yes? Xavier.
Dollar bills.
Dollar bills, those two. We'll put those in there. Okay. Dollar bills for the poor or for people who don't have money. That can be a treasure that we store in heaven to help somebody in their time of need. So the Bible says just to be careful, you know, to save our money, but also to use that money for good purposes. And even more than money, there's other kinds of treasures that moth and rust can't destroy, or thieves break in and steal. Treasures like giving of love or forgiveness, or saying we're sorry. Those things can last forever. Let's have a prayer together. Lord, thank you for the many treasures in life that you give to us, even for the treasure of our children. And we ask, Lord, your blessing upon them, remembering your words to us, let the children come unto me, for such is the kingdom of God. We thank you for the treasure of our children. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you for coming up. Hi, Brielle. Thank you. Friends, we now come to the time in our service when we have the opportunity to pray for one another as a church family, to share with one another our joys and our concerns. So as usual, I'd like to begin this morning with our joys. Do you have any joys that you'd like to share with one another? Alana, are you going to share a joy? Oh, Jeff gave you the new job. Okay.
Me and Jeff, yeah, stealing the job.
I'm just joyful and ask you to join me in that joy. My granddaughter is visiting and staying with me through Thanksgiving, and we'll have the whole family here for Thanksgiving Day. So,
thank you. Fran, remind us of your granddaughter's name.
Zoe.
Zoe, good to have you with us, Zoe. Thank you. Other joys this morning? Yes. Dale?
This year I was lucky enough to find out that unknown to me and my father, I have a sister. And she was adopted years and years ago, and we caught up through DNA research. And on this coming Wednesday, my daughter and I are going to go visit her in Connecticut for the first
wow.
time.
Wow. Dale, I don't know what to say. Congratulations, yeah.
Surprise.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, blessings on your visit with each other.
She's very nice.
Yeah.
We've done that FaceTime stuff. And
wonderful.
We've had a look alike.
Yeah. Well, that's good news. Let's pray for Dale and his visit with his sister. Lord, with grateful hearts, hear our prayers. Amen. Others. Joyce, yes.
Yes, good morning. Following up on Pastor Dave's thank you to all of you for supporting the UWF soup sale, we are truly, truly grateful to all of you. It's overwhelming the support that we get from this congregation. I'm happy to report we've sold 199 quarts of soup in one day, and we have five left. So we would dearly love to sell out.
Yeah, and they're Southwest chicken, I checked. So see Natalie following the service. Yeah. We give thanks. Yeah. Other joys to share. How about concerns? Do you have any concerns? Yeah.
The folks in
Are we going to pay for the folks in Buffalo? How many inches did they get?
6 feet.
What?
6 feet.
6 feet. But Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Vivian wants me to share with you, we had a rental property in Williamstown, and we had to evict the people who were living there. When we went up yesterday, we found out that they had found a way into the house again. So she wants prayers to make sure they stay out of the house and that everybody stays safe.
Yeah. For Candace and Vivian and Steve's home, we pray for safety. Lord, in your mercy. Dolores?
For my friend from the Y, Mary Ann McClone, her and her family, prayers for them. Her husband died about a week ago, so they're in tough.
For Dolores' friend, Mary Ann from the Y, you work together. Her husband passed. We pray for her and her family. Lord, in your mercy.
I don't mean to hog the microphone today. This is vitally important. I've brought this up before. I have a nephew that is a premature child, and we've prayed for him, and so far he's alive. But it is a very, very difficult road, and a lot of decisions have had to be made for his continued survival, which is touch and go. And his name is McCoy Benson. His family, Morgan and Mark, mother and father, please pray for them. It is the most difficult situation I've ever lived through. So prayers are welcome from the entire congregation. Thank you.
Prayers for McCoy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Other concerns this morning? In the back there, Suzanne.
Hi.
Hi, thank you. My daughter-in-law, Nicole Enderly, has a father named Kevin Enderly, who's been critically ill for about 2 weeks now with a rare form of Guillain-Barré. He's in the ICU over at Lankenau. He's very, very ill and going to be there for quite some time, so prayers would be appreciated.
Suzanne, his name again?
Kevin Enderly.
Prayers for healing for Kevin. Lord, in your mercy. Any other concerns? See people pointing. Doris?
I just like prayers for my mother, Marilyn. She, about 2 weeks ago, kind of fell a little bit in the kitchen, twisted her knee, and so she's kind of unable to walk right now very well. So tomorrow she has an MRI, and I'm just praying she didn't tear anything. So we'll find out tomorrow.
Prayers for Marilyn for healing. Lord, in your mercy.
Unfortunately, I have two to mention today. Lori's aunt, Jeanette, who lived in Illinois, passed away on Thursday. This is Lori's father's sister. So prayers to the family of Jeanette Dunn. And additionally, my friend for many years, we were Boy Scout buddies, his mother passed away yesterday morning. His name is Carrie Sterner, so if you pray for the Sterner family.
Prayers for the Dunn and the Sterner family in their loss. Lord, in your mercy.
Now, I have two prayer concerns for if everyone would keep a few old-time friends in their prayers. One is John Green, who about a month and a half ago I had mentioned his wife had end-stage cancer. She ended up passing away about 10 days ago. So if you could keep John Green and Anna, who's his wife, who passed away, in your prayers. And then also, if you could keep in your prayers a longtime friend that I've known since kindergarten, back in the quill pen era. And she's been going through for the past year or so and longer, a lot of physical and health-related issues that she's struggling with, lives down in Georgia. Her name is Mary. So if you would keep her in your prayers as well.
Prayers for Mary, for her well-being. Lord, in your mercy. And Kevin, help me with the first prayer request.
John Green, his wife passed away.
John, in the passing
10 days ago.
Of his wife. Lord, in your mercy.
Continue prayers for my son Peter, who is battling multiple melanoma. He had finished his first session and has no improvements on his numbers. And also to keep my son-in-law Jim in your prayers. He had two major back spine surgeries, and he's still barely able to walk. So they both need prayers, Peter and Jim.
For Dolores' son Peter, who's battling cancer, and her son-in-law Jim, who has spinal problems. Lord, in your mercy. Prayers.
Xavier is currently wearing a heart monitor. We are evaluating for heart failure.
Okay, sorry. Prayers for Xavier. He's the tallest in the family, right, Sophia? Oh, after you. Yeah. Prayers for Xavier and for his well-being. We pray for his heart and healing. Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayers. Any others? Well, we continue to remember the folks in Ukraine and in Russia. We pray for peace in that land. Continue to pray for those folks recovering from hurricanes down in Florida who are, pray for them. And we pray for our nation. Following the recent elections and in moving forward, we pray for the leaders of our country and for its citizenry. All of these we bring together, even now as we pray together as Jesus has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
As the choir makes their way to the front this morning, we're going to be starting out singing Christ in Us Be Glorified. And I think it's just a wonderful time for us, a congregation, just to plead with God that through the prayers we've just prayed, for the folks we've just lifted up, that Christ would be glorified in our prayers, in our community, in our love for one another, in our compassion for those who need it most. So this morning, as we sing, Christ in Us Be Glorified, we want Christ to be glorified in our circumstances, in our prayers, and the things we've just experienced. But we also want Christ to be glorified in the commitments that we make to each other as a community. We want Christ to be glorified in us as we make financial commitments to growing and moving this community, this local church, forward. And we want to ask Christ to be glorified in the decisions we make, so that all that we say and all that we do will lift Christ up, bring hope to the hopeless, life to the lifeless, forgiveness to the forgiveness, and love to those who need it most. Christ in us, be glorified, we pray. Sing that with us as we ask God to give us the courage to say yes to all He invites us to today, tomorrow, and forever. Make your answer to Christ be yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. Here we go.
I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. Will you please join with me in the prayer of the day? Lord Jesus, teach us to store our treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, or thieves break in and steal. Encourage us to love God with all your heart, and help us to love others as you have loved us. Amen. Now, if we can join together in a moment of silent prayer. Amen. Our next hymn, if you will stand and sing, is number 400, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. If you'll remain standing while I read from the Gospel of Matthew. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust consumes and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This morning is the last of our three messages for our annual stewardship campaign entitled Kingdom Stewardship, the Gifts of Time, Talents, and Treasure. On the first Sunday, Pastor Schuller preached on the story, you'll recall, of the poor widow who gave her last two coins to God, dropping them into the temple treasury, recalling the sound of her coins as they turned round and round in that trumpet-like receptacle before finally dropping into the box below. Don likened this sound of the coins going round and round to the sound of Christian discipleship. As we are called to go round and round, maybe not so loudly, but doing the sacrificial work, redemptive work of God in the world, Christian discipleship. Last Sunday, on Lady Sunday, drawing upon the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus reminds his listeners that they are the light of the world, our lay leaders and others shared ways that they are attempting to use their talents, to use their light, to shine in the world, illumine the world, and not to hide them under a basket. This morning on Commitment Sunday, I'd like to talk to you about the third gift that we've been entrusted with to steward, namely our treasure, including our financial resources. I would like us to consider whether or not we are living for treasures or riches that neither moth or rust can destroy, nor thieves break in and steal. And I'd like to begin with a question. Have you ever looked back on your life and wish you had done things differently? Can I see a show of hands? Do you ever find yourself living with regrets? Some years ago now, several of my childhood friends and I started getting together again about once a month, every 6 weeks or so, for a round of golf or when the weather turns cold to go bowling. While most of our time is spent either cutting up on one another, do you still do that with childhood friends? Or sharing, getting caught up with one another's families and the Philadelphia sports teams, rarely do we ever part ways without first reminiscing over our childhood, our adolescence and young adulthood, and rarely without admitting to a list of regrets. Do you ever have regrets? Do you ever wish you could go back in time and could have done things differently? I recently finished a book by author Daniel Pink entitled The Power of Regret, How Looking Backward Moves Us Forward. In his book, Pink cites numerous studies by psychologists and social scientists who have followed groups of people over periods of time, recording both their positive and negative emotions, those which they most frequently feel and mention, including feelings of happiness and excitement, of anger, of surprise and jealousy, in which they found almost unanimously, always near the top, if not the top itself, most often beneath the feeling of love, is the feeling of what? Regret. Regret. In one study in 2008, several social psychologists examined the prevalence of negative emotions in people's lives and found, again in that study, that the emotion they experienced most was regret. But surprisingly, it was also the one emotion that they valued most. In study after study, rather than a negative or abnormal feeling, researchers found that that often stomach-churning feeling that we get when we think that of how things might have been if we had made a different decision in the past is both common and human, and in many ways can be positive. In fact, having no regrets, psychologists tell us, have you ever heard somebody say, oh, I have no regrets? Is actually a sign that there may be more deeper psychological problems. While those having some regrets can often be a sign of a healthy, mature mind, as one can use their regrets to make better decisions today and to find a deeper meaning in life. According to Pink, all regrets fall into four major categories. Maybe some of these will be familiar to some of you. The first are foundation regrets, which represent our failures in the past to be responsible and to think ahead, which now leave us feeling both physically and emotionally vulnerable because of decisions we made in the past. If I had only thought ahead, if I had only stayed in school, studied harder, done the work, if I had only started saving right away, if I had never started smoking, if I had never eaten my first tasty cake. Foundation regrets. Then there are boldness regrets, regrets for the risks we didn't take. If only I had taken the chance, gone out for the high school football team. If only I had gone away to college, chased my true love, asked for that raise or a promotion, started a new business. If only I had retired earlier, learned a new language, took up an instrument. Then there are moral regrets, which according to Pink make up only 10% of all the regrets that he researched, but are the greatest in variety and often the most painful. Moral regrets. If I'd only done the right thing, if I'd only told the truth, if I hadn't have been a bully, if I hadn't had looked the other way, if I hadn't have been unfaithful to my spouse, if I hadn't taken what was mine. Moral regrets. And finally, there are connection regrets, regrets for choosing to neglect or disregard the people who matter to us most. According to Pink, these regrets make up the largest category, connection regrets, stating human beings have a massive amount of regret about broken and unrealized relationships. Connection regrets. If only I had reached out to him. If only I had reached out to her. If only I had listened more, had paid attention. If only I had been willing to change. If only I had said I was sorry. If only I had been willing to forgive. Connection regrets. According to Pink's research, connection regrets are felt more deeply than any other type of regret because they threaten our sense of belonging. Connection regrets. In the longest running study on human development, which began in 1938, with 258 white male undergraduates from Harvard University, later expanded to include their spouse and children, followed over 80 years, Harvard psychologist George Valiant found that more than anything else, what gives our lives significance and satisfaction are meaningful relationships, human connections. Human flourishing, he wrote, can be summarized in five words: happiness is love, full stop. Connection regrets. The Bible is loaded with stories of regret. It's loaded. Regretting that they had eaten of the forbidden fruit, Adam and Eve, you recall, hid from God in the cool of the garden. Famished, Esau regretted selling his birthright to his younger brother Jacob for a bowl of soup. Samson, you recall, regretted giving his secret to Delilah, who then you remember did what? Cut his hair. King David regretted his infidelity with Bathsheba. Judas for betraying Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Peter for denying Jesus three times. And the Roman soldier for participating in Jesus' crucifixion. Do you remember his words from the bottom of the cross? At the bottom of the cross, truly, this was the Son of God. Regret. Jesus tells us numerous stories about regret. The parable of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15, who went off, you'll recall, to a distant country where he squandered his inheritance on riotous and dissolute living until, regretting his decision, returned home to his father's house. The parable of Lazarus and Dives in Luke chapter 16, where Dives feasted sumptuously every day, while Lazarus, a poor man covered in sores, lays at his gate longing to satisfy his hunger with scraps from Dives' table. When both men die, Dives is in hell where he is tormented and thirsts, imploring Abraham to have Lazarus, now in Abraham's bosom, to dip his finger into the water and come and cool his tongue. But it's too late, says Father Abraham, for there is now a great chasm between them that cannot be crossed. Regret. Or the parable of the sheep and the goats in Matthew chapter 25. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, saying, come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. You remember? For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. Naked and you gave me clothing. Sick and you took care of me. In prison and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick and in prison and came and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, you did it unto me. Then he will say to those on his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me. Then they will also answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger, or naked or sick or in prison, and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Regret. Jesus was not adverse to appealing to feelings of anticipatory regret or imagined loss. What does it profit a man, he asks, if he gains the whole world but forfeits his soul? I think Santa Claus is coming. Judge not, lest what? You be judged. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and the road is easy that leads to destruction, and there are many who take it. For the gate is narrow, and the road is hard that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Regret. Everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house upon the rock. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew and beat against that house, but it did not fall, because he had founded it upon rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. Regret. Jesus reminds us that life entails a series of choices. Ours is a series of decisions every day throughout our lifetime, all with the potential for regret, right? So we have to make our decisions wisely. Unfortunately, the reality is that few of the choices that we make in life, from what we choose on a menu or our choice of a spouse or a career, come with the promise of certainty of what we had imagined or hoped for. So much of life appears to be out of our control. Maybe the best we can do if we want a full and meaningful life is, having learned from our past regrets, to make the best choices possible so that we can be our best and most truthful self. And then if life still does not turn out exactly as we had hoped for or imagined, instead of having to live with the if-onlys, we will have the satisfaction of living with at least. At least. At least I finished my degree. At least I took a chance on love. At least I did what I thought was right. At least I was able to forgive him. If we're going to live with regrets, and we all do, at least beat if-onlys any day. Jesus said, "Do not store up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust consumes and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust consume and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Today on Commitment Sunday, the question that is before us is, are we choosing to invest ourselves in treasure that moth and rust will not consume or thieves break in and steal? Or are we investing our lives in treasures that will last, that cannot be taken from us? Are we willing to choose to commit ourselves to the future of St. Paul's, to do the hard work today, to build upon a firm foundation, so that when the rain comes and the water rises, our house will stand tomorrow and in future generations? Are we willing to do that foundation work, that hard work today? Are we willing to be bold enough to take the risk in believing that better days are still ahead for our church, and to invest ourselves in our future, even, I would suggest, financially supporting that tired playground-looking playground out back? In a sign of our faith in our future and in our children and in succeeding generations. Are we willing to do the moral or the right thing, not only love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, but to be here in order to reach out in love and service to our neighbors? Are we willing to do the right thing, the moral thing, to reach out, to be here, and to serve our surrounding community and beyond? And finally, are we willing or wanting today to recommit ourselves to the connections, to the relationships that we share here with one another, here in the sight of God, believing that these relationships, in very large part, give our lives both meaning and purpose, and the feeling that we belong? Four foundational regrets. Foundation, boldness, moral, and connection. The question before us this morning is, are we storing up for ourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust and destroy, and thieves break in and steal, or treasures that will last forever and cannot be taken from us? And if by circumstance or chance things do not turn out the way we had hoped or imagined, at least we'll be able to say, not if only, but at least. Amen. Friends, I'm going to ask Jeff, could you serenade us as we come forward? I'm going to invite, as Jeff plays, if you have brought your estimate of giving card with you this morning. And again, there's different places you can mark if you're not ready at this point to make an estimate of giving. You can check another line. And I invite you to come forward as Jeff plays. come at your own direction, please. Thank you, Jeff. Now that everyone's comfortably seated, will you please rise for our closing hymn, Be Thou My Vision. all soft upon your fields. Until we meet again, may the Lord hold you in the hollow of his hands. Amen.